I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. And this is lesson 8. Now, I said it was going to be 8 to 10 lessons, and that's probably what it's going to end up being, at least 9 or 10 or maybe even 11 lessons. Because I don't want to just skim over a couple of points that are really, really important. One was the age of elders, because that comes up as a discussion point all the time.
Right.
Another one is whether elders and pastors are the same things, or preachers and pastors are the same things.
Right.
A lot of those issues come up. And when we go into the qualifications of elders, we're going to discuss some things as well. And hopefully we'll begin that tonight. But I just wanted to finish up on the work of elders, because I didn't really do that justice in the last lesson. So I'm just going to continue that, the work of elders. And I'm going to finish up with this idea of pastoring, poimeno, to shepherd. Have you ever heard of a situation in a congregation or a church where if an elder didn't like the way things went, they left that congregation and went to another church? An elder? I know some that left, or they left this church, or they left that church. For whatever reasons, they say that they left. They're all over the place. Now, sometimes things change in a congregation, and if the eldership all resigned because they realized they were unqualified, well, then they're unqualified. But I want you to think about this. Some elders in some congregations, if they don't feel appreciated, or when the church comes under a severe attack from Satan, from outside or from within. Because remember, Paul warned the elders at Ephesus that from among their own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things. Grievous wolves will enter in among you, not sparing the flock.
Right.
From among your own selves, men will arise, speaking perverse things. Not just from the congregation, but from within the eldership.
Oh, okay.
Now, I want you to think about how people respond, these shepherds, when they leave the flock. How about a congregation on Long Island where several men in the congregation already sold their homes on Long Island, already purchased and were building new homes in Pennsylvania area, and they knew they were moving, but they wanted to be appointed as elders for the 3 or 4 months that they were going to be left in that congregation on Long Island. They wanted to be elders for 3 months.
Uh-uh.
Basically, what is it? What it is. Or 4 months. Let's even stretch it out to 6 months. But it wasn't that long. And the preacher went along with it and appointed these 3 or 4 men as elders. And then they moved.
Oh, boy.
And the flock didn't move with them. They moved.
They moved. Right.
They left their flock. Turn with me to John chapter 10. And I'm going to share with you a couple of verses that I hope you understand what's being said here. Now, Jesus is talking to a people who were exposed to shepherds all the time. There were many people who shepherded flocks and sheep. Remember the shepherds that were in the fields outside of, was it Bethlehem where Jesus was born? And the angel talked to who? The shepherds.
The shepherds.
The shepherds were a common thing in and around Palestine and Israel at that time. Common. So shepherds and the concept of shepherding a flock was not a foreign concept. Just like if you went out west and you talked to some people at a certain point about a cattle drive, they knew exactly what that was.
Right.
And a cattle drive back in the old days would be across several states. from up north to down south, and then down south back up to up north, and they drove them to where they could feed during certain seasons, and then drove them back. And guys that knew how to do that, they were called cowboys.
Cowboys. Oh.
That's why. Because they drove the cows or the cattle. Well, in this area of the world, in the first century, when Jesus was speaking to these people, he was speaking to people who knew basically what shepherds were and what they did. At least good ones. So what he's talking about is not a foreign concept. In John chapter 10, and in verse 10, Jesus said, "The thief comes only to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I came that they might have life, and might have it abundantly."
Right.
"I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." You know, that's any good shepherd. That's any good shepherd. Do you know that the shepherd staff, what it really looks like? It's not just a stick at the end and then a hook at one end. The typical shepherd's staff had a big bulb on the end, a big ball at the end of that shaft. Or was sharpened. One or the other. Usually like a club.
I see.
Like the end of a bat. And then tapered. And then the other end was a hook. The hook was used to rescue when they got caught in a thicket.
Right.
Or when they got over a cliff or in a ridge and they got down into a hole.
Right.
And they got trapped. The shepherd's staff would be used like a hook, and he would hook them right around the neck. And pull it back and pull them back out and rescue that sheep. Or get it out of water.
Right.
Or whatever, if it was drowning. Anything like that. It was a means of rescue. The other end of that shepherd's staff was the business end, as we call it in our day today.
Okay.
That was used to kill the wolves. That was used to battle the wolves and the lions and the bears. The lions and tigers and bears, oh my. And by the way, back in Palestine in those days, and even before 1000 BC, bears and lions were not unheard of.
Yeah.
David said that he, as a shepherd boy, killed them both with his bare hands.
With his bare hands.
Probably with his shepherd staff too. But he killed two of them defending what? His sheep. Because he was a good shepherd.
Right.
Prepared to, you have to, if you're not going to be running away into the hills when the wild animals come, you're laying down your life, because if you lose, you're on the menu too. You're on the menu.
Right.
He was a hireling. Then he's not saying that in good terms. If you're just a hired hand and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, beholds the wolf coming, and he leaves the sheep, and he flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. And the flock is scattered and devoured, one or the other, or both. He flees. Why? Because he's a hireling. He's not saying that because it's a good thing or that's just the way it is. He's contrasting a hireling with a good shepherd, the good shepherd, Jesus Christ. Right? And he's making an equivalency, equating himself as the good shepherd with a good shepherd, what they knew what a good shepherd would do. They would lay down their life for the sheep. But he flees because he's a hireling and he's not concerned about the sheep. Verse 13. Verse 14, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. And that goes along with what the book of Hebrews said and others that said, know those that have the rule over you in the Lord.
Right.
Know them. How well do you know your elders? Are you really a sheep in the Lord's flock? Because if you are, Jesus said, my sheep know my voice.
Right.
You're going to see that later on in this chapter. But that my own, I know my own, and my own know me. That's the way it needs to be for all poimen, pastors or shepherds in the church. Because that's what they're called. And that's what they're told to do. They start telling him in verse 24, if you are the Christ, tell us plainly. So in verse 25 of John chapter 10, Jesus answered and he said, look, I told you, and you don't believe.
Okay.
Now, he didn't say it like some Bible film. I told you, and you do not believe. He didn't bore the tears off, and he talked plainly to people. So they're asking, tell us plainly if you're the Christ. If you're the Christ, tell us straight out. And he says, I told you, you don't believe. That's the way that conversation sounded in Greek, but that's the way it sounded. Because you're not my sheep. You're not of my sheep. You don't believe me because you're not one of mine. Because my own, what? Know me. He already said that earlier.
Yes.
But you don't believe because you're not one of mine. And that's another way that you can sometimes know whether somebody... You know, I'll say something to somebody about the Bible and they'll say, well, I don't believe that. Yeah, I know that. Oh, you do? Yeah, I know why, too. Why? Because you're not one of his. Because Jesus' sheep hear his voice. They know him. And he knows them. Watch. My sheep hear my voice. And I know them, verse 27. I'm sorry, verse 25, I jumped ahead. I told you, you don't believe. The works that I do, verse 25, in my Father's name, these bear witness of me. My Father is doing things through me, doing the miracles and the healings and the raising of the dead and the blind and the curing the lame and everything. They're bearing witness, and you still don't believe. But you don't believe because you're not my sheep. Verse 26, verse 27. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. That's another thing about shepherding. The shepherds had a unique relationship with their sheep, even if they were going to raise them to someday be slaughtered for food. They were like his little children. He knew them, and they knew him. And the staff was used for one other thing. At least one other thing. Every night, before he put the sheep down to sleep, he would get on one knee or sit down and stick out his staff about this far off the ground. And he would make the sheep. He would call them. And they knew his voice. Anybody else could call, they wouldn't come. But he would call them, and they would jump over the stick, one at a time. And he watched how they jumped. And he would get to see and examine whether they got a broken leg or a sprain, or were wounded, or had thorns, or ticks, or anything else that were on them that shouldn't have been, or that they were wounded, and so that maybe something grabbed them and he didn't see it. So he would see, or they were getting sick from something, or they had an intestinal or internal problem. But he would get to be able to examine them as he had them one by one jump over his stick. his staff, his shepherd's staff. And then he would put them to sleep. He would lay them down. They could sleep for the night, and he would watch.
Very good.
And that's, so the staff was used for at least three major things: to rescue, the business end to defend, the club end of that stick, which was either sharpened to a very sharp point to stab, or was usually a big bulb at the end, so that they could club a wolf or a mountain lion in those days and kill them. Or if somebody else was coming to steal some sheep from the flock for their own flock or to eat. And then the last thing was that he would get down on the knee and he'd call them and they would come. And they'd come around, and they were so well trained, after he heard them, they would come and jump over the shepherd's staff one at a time, and he'd examine them. If he saw something that was a problem, he grabbed that sheep and he'd really give it a once over to really see what the problem was. That's a good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. They hear my voice and they follow. That means that there's trust. That's not, yeah, they're one of the elders, but I don't trust them. Really? Well, obviously, you're not one of the sheep, because their sheep know their voice and follow. So there's a problem either with the leadership or with the fellowship. There's a fellowship problem, because it's either with the leader, the fellowship, leadership or fellowship, which creates a fellowship problem.
Or both.
Or both. There are leaders that don't know how to lead and followers that don't know how to follow. They don't know how to be sheep. They think it's a bad thing to follow, to trust. What does it take to be willing to jump over a stick? You know, I think in terms of military terms, being raised in a Navy house for a period of time in my life, and in going through cadet training myself, you know what? You learn to say, yes, sir. No matter how much you don't like what they're asking you to do. Latrine duty. You know what that is? Latrine?
The toilet.
The toilet. Cleaning the toilets. Latrine duty. Field, get in there. Whatever. You learn to say, yes, sir. No, sir. Aye, aye, sir. Whatever you want, sir. Jump. How high, sir? Is this high enough, sir? You know, you learn to say yes, or to follow orders, to follow the rule. To let them do and let them lead you as not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you, but to take joy in saying yes, sir. So, in the terms of, there are some people in the church that just don't think they need to follow or say yes, sir, to anybody or anything. And they'll say, yeah, to Jesus, maybe, but that's it. Or to Jesus, I'll do it. How do you do that? How do you express that yes, sir, to Jesus? In our day and age, how do you do it? And I tell those people, the only way you'd ever say yes to Jesus is if he personally came down and came into your room and told you to do something. Even maybe then, I doubt it. Because he's already told you what to do and you're fighting it. You're not saying yes, sir. So don't give me that you'd say yes to Jesus but no to man, when you're saying no to him all the time. Because my sheep hear my voice. They know me. And I know them. And they follow me.
Right.
And I give eternal life to them. And they shall never perish. And no one shall snatch them out of my hand. Mm-hmm. So, Jesus protects his sheep. He's not asleep on the job, and he's not the kind of shepherd that flees because he's a hireling, that leaves the sheep. In fact, Jesus said something else about a good shepherd. He said, what does a good shepherd do? He leaves the 99 and goes out to find and seek and to rescue that one which was lost. That's a good shepherd. He makes the effort and will actually leave 100 sheep behind, or 99, to get that 100th sheep and make sure that little lamb is okay.
Yeah.
That's a good shepherd. Is he willing to lay down his life? Is one sheep valuable to him?
Yes.
Nah, he's just one member. We've got all these members to worry about right now. That's the mentality of a lot of elders, a lot of bishops, a lot of pastors, a lot of shepherds in the church today. I can't worry about him or her or him or her, because that's just one or two or three people. And I got 300 or 400 or 2,000 or 3,000 to worry about. No, you've got that one.
Yeah.
Leave the 99 and go rescue that one.
Yes.
That's what Jesus said is a good shepherd. So I just want you to be thinking about that. When we talk about the work of shepherds, I didn't spend enough time on the work of elders on this point. And I want to thank my wife, Patricia, for reminding me of that from last week's lesson, that it was lacking. And it was. So I hope I've covered that a little bit better and you have a little bit more understanding and maybe a little deeper conviction on what it should be and what you haven't been if you're an elder watching this and you haven't been the good shepherd. You haven't been imitating Christ. You haven't been willing to leave the 99 to go out and seek the one and rescue the one. If you haven't been using that shepherd's staff properly, it's more than walking around with a stick, isn't it? It's not an image piece, like so many people will try to use it for an image. It's an actual tool for rescue, for inspection, and for defense. The shepherd's staff.
Yeah.
Well, what is the shepherd's staff today? Are there any equivalencies? It don't look much like a shepherd's staff, but that's exactly what it is.
Okay.
It's exactly what it is. Come on. Is it used to rescue? Can it be used to rescue?
Yeah.
Save somebody from drowning? What else? What's better than the Word of God? Can it be used to defend against wolves?
Yes, sir.
The Word is sharp.
As a two-edged sword.
Is it able to inspect?
Yes.
Neither is there any creature hidden. It lays open and lays bare. James says, it's a mirror in which you can behold yourself. You can examine yourself, let alone other people, through the Word.
Yeah, through the Word. Yeah.
Through the Word. So it's just like that shepherd's staff. So if you don't know the Bible as a shepherd, you're no shepherd. You're no shepherd. Resign. Do the right thing. Get qualified. Then seek the office. Then seek the work.
The work.
The work. Because that's what it is. If any man desires the office of a bishop, dear bishop, he desires a good work. A good work, the good shepherd, just like Jesus.